Hi, I'm Chris C, founding director of the Cardstack Project, coming to you from the land of the Web3. I want to welcome many of the new members to our community to the Cardstack Project. As you know, Cardstack is building the decentralized software ecosystem using Web3 technology, blockchain economics, and most importantly, open source and open collaboration so that we can build competitor to the Silicon Valley software ecosystems all together. And one way to do it is to ensure that we all share in one economic value so that we can pay each other to distribute revenue, to be able to fund not only new product that people buy with premium, but also spread some of those revenue to upstream capability, maybe software projects or open source you use, but more importantly, allowing to pay commissions, to pay royalties to different participants that make that sale possible. So one of the things we want to catch you up on is what we plan to do in the next 3 quarters in launching Cardstack in stages. The first thing we're building and is the framework, but the first thing we're launching is actually a payment protocol that builds on top of DeFi payment capability. And I'm going to spend a little time to you to catch you up on CardPay, which is our DeFi payment stack. So let's begin. When you think about payment, the first thing that comes to mind is Visa and MasterCard. They are accepted everywhere in the world, and you can use a card in some cases, other mechanism or using your numbers online to buy almost anything in the world. But in China, with the spread of mobile app like Androids and in lesser extent iOS, there are apps that exist in your mobile app where you can scan a code in a merchant or with each other and pay each other. And that's the WeChat and Alipay. And obviously, the OS providers are like, hey, we can do this too. So Apple Pay and Google Pay at the operating system level within your phone provide those capability to use the proximity sensors or use your biometrics, face ID, touch ID to be able to do payments. These are the traditional payment that uses the traditional finance as a clearance mechanism. Now, obviously, China is a little bit different, but ideally, this is all based on fiat backing. And as we look at Web3, which is in the blockchain space, we're introducing a new type of acceptance network. So it's called CardPay. CARD, the acronym stands for Customer Acceptance, for CA, and Revenue Distribution. So that is a new type of network that allows you to use Web3, the type of wallet connect, the stable coins and other reward tokens as a way to augment the payment ecosystem beyond what's currently on the screen. So let's go jump right in. So CardPay is a DeFi payment and reward system. And we have two ways for people to set up and actually pay. One is through a web dApp. And this is where we actually use layer one and layer two technology to onboard token values from Ethereum mainnet, which is our layer one, onto a cheaper and faster layer two network. And so if you have tokens or stable coins in layer one, you can stake them in the pool, what we call a reserve pool, and that will allow you to become essentially a token supplier in layer two in exchange for some reward, whether it's a percentage of transaction or some sort of staking reward. And once you have those token in layer two, you can then issue these prepay balances, like preloaded cards. They're basically wallets that you can give to people, and it contains everything that's in there. So it looks somewhat like a little bit of a this kind of a prepaid card that you can have in your wallet. And if the merchant can also say, I will issue prepaid card, I will accept prepaid card. And you can configure that within this web dApp. But the users don't have to deal with any of this stuff and don't have to pay the high fee of Ethereum mainnet. All they have to do is to use the mobile app to connect a dApp, a storefront, or connect with another user or another merchant, and then be able to pay each other. Merchant can also use the same app as a point of sale devices, so you can actually scan each other's QR code between two phones and actually settle using layer two technology that's based on the Ethereum smart contract. So that's basically it. So there's CardPay dApp, which is our dashboard, and then there's CardPay mobile app we call the Card Wallet. And This dApp, which is what we are using to onboard new customers, is actually a general based on a general purpose workflow system. So we allow users to take many more steps, some of them pretty complicated. If you use it, use the current dApps today, you know you have to switch between four or five different dApps, figure out how to use MetaMask. We make it all very much streamlined. So for example, this is a particular workflow that allows you to create your own prepaid card, decide what color it is, what design it would go into it, and that creates that kind of look and feel. And after you create a look and feel, you're able to decide what of the bridge token you want to use to load it up. It's kind of like going to a drugstore or phone store to load up your card. And once you have it, you just have to use your wallet to approve it. And so that we do not do anything on the web dApp until you sign it using a wallet and give it permission. And once you do that, you get a little nice NFT badge that now become an issue in your network. So you can issue your own personal card for your friends to use. You can give it to your aunt so they can use cryptocurrency without having to do all this bridging and setup. But this can also be from commercial providers who are using this prepaid card to allow them to access maybe an existing exchange balance, if it's a centralized exchange, or a fiat on-ramp will allow you to deposit various currency and maybe even allow you to offboard currency if earned this way. So different prepaid issuer, it's kind of like different banks or different organizations that can create Visa and MasterCard. They can also issue these card stack-based payment mechanisms. So once you have a prepaid card, then you have this in your wallet, and then you can just kind of choose which one to use. It supports both stablecoins, so it's close to USD value, or it could also support what we call reward cards, which are cards that wrap values of either community tokens or other type of volatile token that you can pay. Not all merchants will accept the volatile tokens, but maybe if you're in a network, they're going to demand that you redeem it using the network token that is part of the community. And once you select which payment method you use, you will just pay it, and we will have a very, very smooth experience where you can use Face ID or Touch ID, approve it, and that's when we actually pay the merchant, settling on a layer 2 chain using token backed by layer 1. So when the merchant earns enough of these, you know, $5 and $15, they can then take it in bulk and bring it back to mainnet, bring it back to the decentralized exchange and trade it for currency or they want, whether that's ETH, Bitcoin, or even off-ramp through a provider, service provider into fiat. So that's the mobile wallet for biometric payments. Recently, we announced a partnership with Chainlink, which uses the Chainlink price feed for what we call rate lock. So price feed is a very important payment system, especially if you've ever traveled internationally, we use a Visa card. It's anchored to a bank in your local denomination. And we go to travel in Europe, for example, a conversion needs to happen, and sometimes they show it to you when you're checking out, hey, do you agree with this rate? And you're really hard to know if that rate is fair, too high, too low. But with DeFi, we have very reliable price feed based on actual trading activity between people on decentralized and centralized exchange. So we're using those price fees to determine how much something's worth. What is a DAI, which is a stablecoin, worth? What is an ETH worth? And obviously, what a community token like CARD, Cardstack token, worth? And based on that, we can then display to the user what is their balance worth and how much purchasing power that they have. And that's how is what is displayed in the actual price feed itself. So in the protocol, when the merchant says, hey, I want to price this product for $50, the merchant is essentially saying that as long as you can give me a token where at the time of the purchase is with $50, I will sell you whatever you want, whatever is behind this thing. So this would be essentially a way where the price feed is not only just for display for the use, so you know how much you have to spend purchasing power in your wallet, but it's also a way for the revenue pool, which is a clearance mechanism between the customer and merchant, to determine how many tokens that we need to withdraw from your prepaid card. Let's say a stable coin, it's a little bit higher, so it needs a little less DAI to fulfill this. And the merchant would now get that number of tokens, and they take the risk of the exchange rate from that moment forward. But if it's actually a volatile token, you can now start seeing the advantage, right? So you now can have a agree on a rate lock instead of doing through a message or telegram of say, hey, I want to pay you in Bitcoin. What is the rate This is automatically determined by a DeFi price feed from organization like Chainlink, which has network of validators and data providers, and that is the most accurate and fair price. And there's only one price, no spread, no margin on it. It's not foreign exchange fees. There's no profit being made in exchange. It is just how many tokens that the customer needs to pay the merchant, and the merchant can then in bulk at the end of the day, end of the week, end of the month, withdraw all of the tokens they've earned. It could be stablecoin, it could be the card token, which is reward token, and it can be ETH, it could be wrapped BTC, it could be anything, and they can put it into a safe. This is actually based on a Gnosis safe, a smart contract wallet, and so multiple manager can have different multi-sig relationship, so they can then decide when to withdraw this to another account or disperse it to pay vendors and upstream like that. So that's how we use DeFi Oracle price stream that is used in trading for payment use case, so that we can approach the usability and the simplicity of using a credit card in an international country and knowing that, you know, hopefully the fair payment is being deducted from you and being paid to the merchant. And what we're launching this quarter, it's pretty exciting, is this dashboard, which allows you to buy and issue a prepaid card, create a merchant services so that you can have a merchant account and like a deposit box so that you can now accept payments on using card pay and using just the token back wallet as a way to transact. And obviously, this dashboard will grow over time. But more importantly, this is only one of the things we're building. So the card pay system, which allows us to create a seamless payment and reward network, will be the first thing we launch. And that, with that, we'll launch the dApp, the wallet, and the smart contract to back the card protocol with the integration with the Chainlink oracles. And then next, and you can say, well, if I have the ability to pay people, like PayPal or something like that, why, you know, I would like to have a storefront. I would like to build a store so I can go ahead and show people what I'm able to, what my prices are, what my discounts are. If you pay my community token, I'll give you a discount. If you hold that many of my NFT, I'll give you 50% off. There's a lot of really interesting opportunity to mix the NFT and the community membership building in crypto to create storefronts that has really interesting gameplay. So the more loyalty you have, the more you purchase, you might actually reveal product that's only available to a small subset user. We're working on that simultaneously, but more importantly, all the configuration of your storefront, which we call a card space as a hosting service, is entirely no code. You could just point and click and configure it and launch it on your slice of the decentralized web so that you have your own place where people can see, connect the wallet and pay you and transact with you without having to worry about WordPress or getting Shopify's. This is all native within Web3, sign on using a wallet, a mobile wallet, and then pay using the store value control within the wallet. Now, then you say, you know, what if I want to do more? What if I want to sell consulting services? Can I do invoices? So this is where Card Catalog comes in. Cardstack has been a project that's been a few years in creation. And before we got a lot of the protocol stuff, which requires a lot of pieces in the Web3 to mature, we were working on a way to build modules that can extend this card space, this hosting system. And those modules, those UIs are critical because developer can use our SDK and build new tools that can be sold to merchants and customers and businesses where they can incorporate and drag and drop in a software marketplace new feature in the card space. So maybe we start out as a simple storefront to replace Shopify, but in the future, it may actually be a way where you can sign contract and where the payment system is selling not tens of dollars of value, maybe millions of dollars of value, and there's multiple agreement going back and forth. Each one of these are software modules, plugins, and visual manifestation of these mini application we call cards that you can combine them to this idea. So we go from a payment protocol so that we provide economic brand bandwidth to create a hosting system for the Web3 app and then extend it through a community driven effort where developer contribute new software to a catalog that can be used and more importantly paid for using this revenue distribution mechanism that we put together. And this is really a symbiotic relationship. These are not three different applications that is trying to do three things. They're part of this virtuous cycle that we're trying to create in Cardstack, which is that at the end of the day, you know, Web3 is about having a slice of a decentralized web so that you can go ahead and create your own space of which people can transact, and you can provide reward to them, or competitors or other organizations can say, hey, because you spend X dollars, here's a free NFT, or here's a 2 points, and so you learn about my services or be more loyal to my customers. And based on those reward, developer gets paid, designer gets paid, maybe salespeople and commission people, maybe influencers gets paid. And that allows them to go ahead and commission new software, new products that they can go and say, hey, you know, I'm going to take some of the money I've earned to build new capability so I can create more stuff. And that's all within the Cardstack platform, all within a cohesive user experience that can bring it all together. So when someone say, hey, I learned about Cardstack, what is it all about? What you need to think about is that we are really about building a software ecosystem that's general purpose. The same way Ethereum went and say, hey, we're building a computational platform with a blockchain backing it that's general purpose. We want developers to come and build new capabilities on top of our software framework. But here's the thing. If we don't show people how to build the first and second and third thing, it'll be hard for people to imagine in the abstraction of what does it mean to build modular and composable software. But by having a payment app, a great mobile experience, a dApp that has a nice workflow and dashboard capability, and a storefront capability so you can drag and drop, we can now people say, hey, this is great. What if I want more features? That's when they realize Cardstack is extensible, and all the extensions are monetized, and we're going to build a larger and larger community of developers who are going to see this as a way to express their will or their desire to share the knowledge and share the gifts of making software. But it's not locked inside a Google or Facebook. It's open source software built on open value system with open distribution. And that's the exciting thing that I want to have you guys understand. And we're going to work towards this vision to bring the community together to grow each part of these silos and bring it together, the cohesive experience, so that when people think of Cardstack, they think of, ah, that's the experience layer of Web3. That's where I will come in and learn how to leverage all these Web3 and blockchain tools. And it's how I'm going to introduce my friends, my family, and my businesses, and my boss, maybe become my own boss, to say, hey, I'm going to build my own business, my own identity, and my own growth in this platform. We want to make it easy to use, as easy as Alipay and WeChat Pay, as convenient as Visa and MasterCard. And it's going to be something that's in your pocket, you know, follow wherever you go, because this phone that you have is your identity and it's your wallet. And I want to make sure that you guys know that this is coming. The first step is card pay, and I can't wait for you guys to try it out and get me some feedback. So thank you very much for your time today. I will give you more updates in the YouTube channel. So subscribe if you want to hear from us. Otherwise, I'll see you next time. Thank you.